everybody. Today I'm going to read from several books. Oh, don't forget your so wear your masks, please. Everybody wear your masks, please. I'm trying to keep the spread of this. So today I'm gonna start with this.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies crying. Much more than I ever knew, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Like we are, but we're not going to have such a wonderful world anymore. Really, you know, everybody in Washington is totally out of control. I mean, just total lawlessness. Total lawlessness in this town. And none of the lawyers, my landlord is a lawyer. He's threatening that he's going to throw me out on the street. Because unemployment's not paying me, so I keep on, because he said, oh, that's your problem. I said, no, it's the landlord's problems as well. And you people better get on the stick and get together and start going over and getting the money into the pockets of the people who are on unemployment. And so they can pay you. The economy, it doesn't help for all of this money to be promised to people if it's not getting into their pockets. And this attitude of, it's not my problem, it's not my problem. I mean, everybody in this town is like that. Everybody. I mean, this is not what the Founding Fathers envisioned. I'm going to get into that next time with John Dickinson. the landlord says, that I keep on telling all of these people, I'm like, you got a problem with my argumentation, with my legal stance? Tell me what it is. Stop insulting me. No. Your argumentation is like a two-year-old. Where? No, they just insult you. See, this is the problem with the bullying in this town. And you see it up on Capitol Hill. You see it everywhere. Nobody can. There's another with Tip O'Neill that I was looking at earlier. Before, you know, they could have before all of the minorities came in, and it used to be just the white men, you know, they used to have actual debates and not try and kill each other and insult each other. I mean, all anybody does is insult each other. I mean, you can't. I'm like, wait a second, you got a problem with me? Don't insult me that I'm stupid, fat, or ugly, or you know, whatever you want to come up with. Tell me where your problem is. Is there a problem with my argumentation and what I'm presenting to you, either in economics, either in politics, either in the law, something like that? I don't have a problem discussing it with you. But if you're just going to attack me and say I'm stupid and I don't know what I'm talking about because you don't understand what I'm talking about, yeah, I got a problem with that. And I'm not going to sit there and let you waste my time busting my chops over stupid, you know, stuff. I explain things. I mean, I'll get into this soon with Dr. Spock. I mean, these narcissists and everybody in this town and the 10 percenters, they don't, I was actually talking to my sister about this earlier. You know, since they don't even know how to deal with the small little problems in daily life. And so, of course, the bigger ones, I mean, forget it. But these are our leaders. These are the people who are supposed to be leading the world and supposed to be examining all of our problems and finding solutions. And they can't even deal with the daily BS. And so they get all bent out of shape. They know they're incompetent. So they get all pissed off and they start screaming and yelling and bullying everybody and insulting everybody. And that's what this town is. And it's transformed this country into it. And I mean, it's got to stop. And as I say, I'll get into this with John Dickinson. This is what the founding fathers were so pissed off with the British. Otherwise, they wouldn't have left. Or separated. Okay, so today I'm going to start with Third World America by Arianna Huffington. This is one, in a, you know, another sellout artist. Yes, blah, 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 all of her rhetoric. But then she does Huffington Post. Huffington Post is like an online cosmopolitan. I mean, just another magazine, just another, you know, blah, 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 blah. And I'm sure she got $100 million or whatever. I mean, her husband, I know, had money. So, of course, in the divorce, he was gay. I mean, it's the typical story I've seen out there. I don't know how many times. You know, she married rich. At least she was honest about it. You know, he was, well, bisexual or whatever. It was obviously a marriage of arrangement. And she walked away with lots of money. Like, she wanted to, and like so many other women. I never was playing that game. And that's why I'm here, putting up with these assholes and sitting there, you know, fighting to keep a roof over my head. I mean, this is absolutely ludicrous. This woman's Greek. Now, the Greek correct restaurant where I've been working, Kalari, I could explain the Greek crisis and the need for a bailout from the IMF with a case study on that restaurant alone. I mean, really, if some lawyers don't wake up and start helping me, this is going to be a bloodbath. Because I can tell you, my blood's boiling. But you won't ever get me violent or anything like that. But I know a lot of people behind me, and with good reason. So, you know, pick your poisons. Uncomfortable stuff now with some of the people that you know who are going to go down, or watch your children, your wives and children being raped and pillaged. Well, your wives and children being raped and your homes being pillaged. You know, I mean, I don't know why everybody thinks that this time it'll be different. Okay, this was 2010, 2011, I guess she republished it. When I sat down to write Third World America in the spring of last year, my goal, as I put it in the preface, was to sound the alarm so the United States could course correct while there was still time. In the year since, much has happened in America, including a midterm election in which the still struggling economy was front and center, and which resulted in what President Obama called a shellacking of the Democrats and of the status quo. So has the alarm been heeded? Any honest observer would have to say no, not with the urgency that the ongoing decline of the middle class demands. At the same time, the fact that the American dream has turned into a nightmare for millions of middle class families has finally entered the national conversation. Everybody has the conversation. But who's putting their money where their mouth is? Indeed, as I write this, the cover story of Time magazine is a debate between the competing claims that yes, America is in decline, and no, America is still number one. And in President Obama, the only time we were number one was after World War II, when everybody else had almost destroyed themselves. And that's why we became number one. And in President Obama's State of the Union address in January, it was clear that the future of America's middle class was foremost in his mind. At stake, he said, is whether new jobs and industry take root in this country or somewhere else. It's whether the hard work and industry of our people is centered on family homelessness, a lack of safety, comfort, privacy, reassuring routines, adequate health care, uninterrupted schooling, sustaining relationships, and a sense of community. And the problems are getting worse. The percentage of children living in low-income families went from 37% in 2000 to 42% in 2009. Using the president's yardstick of charting our progress by the opportunities we pass on to our children, we're certainly not winning the present. Not with 2.2 million homes in the process of foreclosure, not with consumer bankruptcies expected to exceed 1.5 million in 2011, not with a crumbling infrastructure that will require $2.2 trillion over 5 years to fix, and not while we're spending $2.5 billion a week on wars in Afghanistan and Iraq that are not essential to our national security. But despite all of this, the experience of writing this book and then traveling around the country talking about it ultimately left me feeling hopeful. So see, they write a book, get a book deal, travel around the country and schmooze and cruise and everything like that and think that they, you know, now they know everything. I mean, one of my favorites was with Michael Cohen when they were questioning him up, I guess it was the House, after the whole thing with Trump and Lanny Davis was the one who represented him. And they said to him, "Do you promise not to write a book?" He said, "No." "Do you promise not to start a business and make money off of all of this?" "No." I knew where they were coming from. You know, even the people up on Capitol Hill are a bit tired of everybody, you know, doing all of this illegal stuff or you know, cashing in on the cesspool, writing a book about it, and making even more money. We have all of the evidence. I mean, all of the books that have been published in the past 30, 40 years, all of the evidence to launch the Nuremberg trials too, is here. Now, why can't I get anybody's help in doing it? Instead, I get harassed and bullied and threatened to be thrown out on the street again. I mean, everybody wants to throw the rich white woman out on the street. Oh, they just love to denigrate and destroy her. I mean, you would think, I mean, these are Americans. They don't care about their country. They don't care about anything except their own pocketbooks. And that is just the problem here in Washington. I mean, the rest of the country, it's time you guys got mad. I mean, really, really. I mean, this the whole thing is fraud. It's all under RICO. I mean, The Godfather, Mario Puzo even makes the point that, you know, the Godfather and the Sicilian Mafia is like, wait a second, we're not doing anything that nobody else, you know, everybody else is doing. And that's how it's justified. If everybody is doing it, then we can too. And that's exactly how it works. But, you know, I mean, the whole town. And the problem with the legal community, every single lawyer who covers this up becomes complicit. So law firms, you know, this is a black and white, win or lose. I mean, either you're on the side of the oppressors or you're on the side of the liberators. So, let's see. And while we're still spending $2.5 billion a week on wars in Afghanistan and Iraq, they are not essential to our national security. Exactly. We've got to stop with these wars. But despite all this, the experience of writing this book and then traveling, feeling hopeful. It's because I was again and again struck by people's resilience, creativity, and the act of compassion that I discovered taking place all across America. Okay, but you know, people are getting pissed off. This was 10 years ago. They convinced me that we can turn things around as long as we demand more from our political and business leaders and more, much more, from ourselves. And that's why, since the book was published in speeches and on Huffington Post, I focused much of my attention on the specific steps we as individuals, as family, and as a country need to take to stop our free fall. Yeah, I've written, you know, volumes about what needs to be done, what needs to be done, what needs to be done. But if you can't, you know, get them to implement, and you can't take them to court for fraud because they're not implementing, it's just blah, 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 blah. I've come across so many people who have gone beyond their own struggles and found ways to help others. One of the surprising twists has been people discovering that by reaching out to help others, even when they themselves are suffering, they end up improving their own lives. Yeah, okay, well, yes, the past 15 years, the past 20 years, this has actually started in Bogota, 2003, when my ex crashed and burned, which is also my beef with the IMF. The people who are working in the banking systems, you know, the guys at the top, the CEOs, they're raking in the big bucks, but everybody else is being stressed to the max, and you know, it's creating mental problems, it's creating health problems, it's creating, you know, family problems. I mean, it destroyed my ex-husband and destroyed my family and my life. And here they're all sitting pretty going, no, sorry, you're just a, you know, casualty. The sacrificial lamb. Well, I'm not being anybody's sacrificial lamb. You guys can be my sacrificial lamb. So, I charge my clients very little or nothing at all, she says, lawyer who does pro bono work. They can't afford to pay me. If you can't afford your mortgage, you probably can't afford a lawyer. Although she is working harder and earning much less, she says that she never felt happier. When I know I've kept somebody in their home, the feeling is so amazing. I know how I'd feel if I was in danger of losing my home and someone helped me stay in it. Yes, this is fine, but and this I know that the victims of domestic abuse, we're all tired of it. The lawyers, I'm helping you, pro bono. It's like, wait a second. If you guys were doing your job properly, then I wouldn't have to keep on going into court and have another lawyer and have another lawyer and have another lawyer. Of course, that's what this lawyer is throwing out at me. You know, guess what? You're going to have to go into court. You're going to need to get a lawyer. Now, when I went down to D.C. Landlord Tenant Court in 2016 and got all of the evidence that I needed to take them to the international courts and launch an investigation by Congressman Holmes Norton into all the crap that's going on down there, which, of course, she sat on, her staffer sat on, I told the mediator, I said, look, I am adamant. Every single person who comes into a courtroom has to have a court-appointed lawyer. Now, you need to get some competent court-appointed lawyers out there, but you first need to, you'll get rid of, this is why so many women are going to court to represent themselves. And this is something that I keep on telling everybody. No, that is not the road to go down. We need to fight for us to have the right for legal representation. Because with me, yeah, I'm a barrister. I've argued it. But I don't know all of the procedural stuff to, you know, submit everything to the courts. That's why you have this two-tiered system. In Britain, it's barristers and solicitors. In Spain, it's abogados and procuraduras. The procuraduras are supposed to be the lawyers, and the abogados are supposed to be the barristers. Neither one. I mean, what they just did was put another, since the barristers, nobody knows how to argue, you're just paying for two lawyers. So, you know, until the lawyers get some understanding of the law, we're all screwed. And what they're doing then, you know, they're doing malicious litigation against people. That's what happened to me with Landlord-Tenant Court. Totally illegal what the landlord did. Totally. As I said, in the other, in an 18-month period, from my rent went from $750, $900. I paid the extra extortion, $950. I paid the extra extortion because I have to keep on moving. But when she jacked it up to $1,800 a month, I'm like, no. I mean, come on. As they say in Spanish. And she waltzed in there at 8 months. I had to go through all of that stuff to get all of the evidence I needed. I got it, but I can't find anybody to help me to submit it to the international courts or submit it to Congress Holmes Norton and put everybody who is supposed to be overseeing this up against the wall and get them to start doing their jobs. That's all I'm asking of anybody. And nobody wants to do it. Nobody wants to get involved. The problem is when they do that, then you just implicate yourself in the cover-up for all of the illegal activity going on in this city, and you become implicated under RICO and the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act, because the corruption is, I mean, now with globalization, it's all over. So the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act is really easy, because almost everybody is international these days. Let's see. Although a deep-seated cynicism is not an unreasonable, another thing. Yeah, she feels, you know, good about helping somebody. Yes, okay, but this is why, you know, back in the 70s, the development community said we need socioeconomic development, not charity. We gotta stop with the charity like this. Socioeconomic development, you clean up your courts in the first place, and your banking systems in the cases of the mortgages, and you're not dealing with this. But of course, see, this is the conflict of interest with the legal community, because there's an incentive, because they're raking in the money. You know, they get it anyway. Win or lose, based off their pockets. Although a deep-seated cynicism is not an unreasonable response to the failure of Washington to address the problem we face, hundreds of thousands of Americans across the country are choosing to react by taking action. As a result, a parallel economy is being created by people who, finding there are no jobs, have decided to create their own. Of course, this burgeoning parallel economy doesn't mean the government is off the hook. Okay, just for one moment, this, you know, for example, in Spain, when I mean, my sister lived there in the 70s, I went to Portugal in the mid-70s, and then, but, you know, Spain and all of Southern Europe, you know, it was all black economy. I mean, almost everything was under the table, and that was one of the things when they got into the European Union, was try and get, you know, everybody to be paying their taxes and using bank accounts. They call it financial inclusion and fiscal responsibility and but you get people going into the black markets and working in the black markets because they know that the tax money is being used to stuff the pockets of the people in power. And it's not being used for the people. So yeah, I'm not going to be the schmuck and pay taxes. No. Black market. And that's how you get the black market developed with all of the problems that come in with it. It just, you know, perpetuates corruption within your police. Because, of course, you know, you need to start bribing the police, your courts, everywhere. It's the same thing with the drug production, the prohibition, or the failed war on drugs. It just invites corruption. And so the policymakers need to stop with the more laws, more laws, more laws. We got to just, you know, lock them up, lock them up, lock them up, and control, control, control. We'll get into that power and control, this power over paradigm. It's got to stop. But while millions of Americans are waiting for the government to do the right thing, many are taking matters into their own hands. And through the creative use of technology, social media, and a focus on community, this new wave of small businesses is making its mark in a true convergence of left and right. Our government may be can't do, but more and more of our citizens are solidly can do, and irrepressibly American. At the moment, real solutions are less likely to come from politicians than from the thousands of people in thousands of communities taking the initiative to connect, share, and create. This movement is fueled by technology, but at its core is a real person connecting with another person. As Twitter co-founder Biz Stone has said, Twitter is not a triumph of tech, it's a triumph of humanity. Well, we see what Twitter and Facebook and all of these platforms have been doing and where this has ended up. Because once again, it was just started by greedy, Silicon Valley techie startups. Silicon Valley, huge problem with mental health issues. Like 90% of the people are because it is a totally dysfunctional situation. And the money, the capital venturist, I'll get into this later on, but I'll show you. When I was looking for capital venture money for global expats, that's when I found out, no, it's just they may have let in, it might not be Vanderbilt and Mellon and the old guard that is in there. Now we've got Mark Cuban and you know, other minorities. Still same BS. I mean, these guys, they don't do their homework. They're in the loop, so they get an idea and they go, okay, how much you need? Write it. He lost it. Oh, okay, no worries, no worries. Got another idea? Come on, bring it all over. I mean, this is my activism website. But I'll go into this in another presentation. But I have my Global Expats project here and my business plan. Everybody's like, lady, this is the best business plan I've ever seen in the world. The idea is still a very, very good one. It's a cross between LinkedIn, Facebook, TripAdvisor, and Yelp.com. But for a target market of about 300 million expatriates abroad. And, you know, aggregately, when you're looking at the spending of a family, if you will, they get their paycheck. It goes into the bank account. Well, that paycheck, your bank account, that bank is, you know, one of the recipients of the consumer. So already they're getting that through. Well, then they're also spending money, you know, so they put it in the local bank. But then they also are using that money, maybe some for savings, not usually, to buy clothes, to buy food within the local economy. So once again, they're a big client of, in the real estate market, in the grocery stores. And I mean, these are not luxury family. These are not people who buy yachts. And they're the 10%ers. I mean, most of them are 10%ers of the expatriates. If you get into the immigrant populations, I mean, it's still, the project is still applicable for them. I mean, I'm still fighting for their rights, because mine is not just, oh, well, here's a whole bunch of people who spend a lot of money. Now, here, advertisers, now I want to rake in. Yes, I need to make money for everything that I want to do. I mean, obviously, I'm sitting here, my landlord threatening to throw me out on the street. Yeah, I can't get a job because discrimination against white Americans is so bad in this town. You know, particularly the deposed trophy wives opting back in, who don't want to pay their little game and who are calling them all out. And that's why, you know, I'm almost out on the street where everybody else is sitting in their million-dollar homes with their cushy little jobs and creating havoc. I mean, this comes back to the Narcissism Epidemic book. We have to start holding people to account. I mean, Anne-Marie Slaughter, there's very few people in this world who are as qualified as I am for all of these jobs. Well, I want you to be held responsible for all of the crap that's going on within the International Bar Association. Why didn't you do anything when you were there? It was Harvard, I think it was Harvard that she was at the law school there. Excuse me. Harvard is churning out more PhDs and MBAs who never graduated from kindergarten than anybody else, I think. And they're some of the worst out there who are gonna end up in prison. I mean, we're going to have an alumni list of Harvard next to the name. In prison. And this is your wonderful Ivy League school? I mean, Harvey Eisenberg, he's one of the lawyers to help build this house of cards with his merger and acquisitions. Brilliant guy. GW? Look what you're producing, and all of your other departments, the DV Leap, your human rights clinic,